Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you today in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful as we come into your house. We can celebrate, we can rejoice. We can lift our hearts and our hands to you, God, just experiencing your presence and your goodness, God, your favor and your blessing. Lord, today we don't want to stop there. We want to go farther with you. As we open your word today, God, we pray that you open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Today, Lord, truly we didn't come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, we've come to hear from you. Be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives so we can be all you've called us to be and do all that you've called us to do. Give us that motivation and that encouragement we need, Lord, and we will readily apply the word of God to our lives, Lord, and we will see its blessings and its fruit given to each and every one of us, Lord. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. God, there are brothers and sisters, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we'd ask that you bless the Baptists, the Lutherans, the Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapel, for Harvest, for the Well and the Way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, all the great churches that are out there, too many to name by name. God, we thank you for Victory and for the Assemblies and Foursquare denominations, God. Thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord. If they're lifting up your name, preaching your gospel, we bless them as you would bless us. God, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world, Lord. We pray that you strengthen them, encourage them, bless them, protect them, God. May they never give up, Lord. May they endure to the end. And Father, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Today, get your Bibles and go with me to Hebrews, the 11th chapter. And today, we're starting a new series called Homeland. You'll see where we find that in the Word of God in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. This is part number one. Myself and the teaching team, we're going to be rotating through, teaching different parts out of Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse number 13 through verse number 16. Now, we were designed as people, as humans, for a place. God had it in mind when he created each and every one of us, that there was going to be an eternal dwelling for each and every one of us. And in that design, the Bible tells us in the book of Ecclesiastes that God has set eternity in the hearts of man. And throughout our lifetime, we're trying to find that eternal element. We're trying to find those eternal things. There's a search that goes on in each and every one of us. We were not designed to be comfortable here on the earth. There's a longing on the inside of each and every one of us. Some have called it the God-sized hole in our hearts that can only be filled with himself. And therefore, the temporary things of this earth are always trying to replace the eternal things. We all know what has happened in our past lives and past times when we tried to fill that void on the inside of us, when we tried seeking eternal things and tried to fulfill it with natural things, with sex and drink and alcohol and drugs and dancing and fame and fortune, wealth and pursuits and accomplishments. We had all these things and we tried to fill it, but it always came up empty. And we realize that, you know what, I'm not satisfied with just this. I'm not satisfied with temporary. I'm not satisfied with enough or more than enough here on the earth. But there was an eternal longing on the inside of us that kept drawing us on. The question for all of us today is this: are we willing to let go of the earthly for the heavenly? Are we willing to release the literal and the carnal for the spiritual and the eternal? C.S. Lewis said this. He said, if we find ourselves with a desire that nothing in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that we were made for another world. Now, let's say we were going on a trip, okay? Each and every one of you individually, just put yourself in this position. You were going to be traveling, okay? And so you packed up at home, got your clothes and that sort of thing, and you went out and you drove a far distance away. And when you got there, you found a hotel and you rented a room for the night. Now, you got into the room, you put your stuff down. It's a nice room, you know, good size, comfortable, that sort of thing. But you started looking around and you go, man, this room is kind of stark, just kind of hospital white. It's not really that attractive. You know, they should have put some colors on the wall. At least, you know, something soothing while you're here. You know, you should really be comfortable in a hotel room. That bedspread is ugly. I don't know who thought of that. That's just terrible. They don't even have a sense of design. You're looking around and you're going, you know, there's not even paintings on the wall. There's no art, nothing. Now, how many of you sitting in that hotel room for one night would go down to Home Depot and start buying gallons of paint and start getting brushes and tape and all that kind of stuff, and then went over to Aaron Brothers and picked up a couple of paintings and some artwork that you like, and you head on over to Bed Bath & Beyond, and you picked out linens and picked out a new bedspread and pillows and shams and all that? How many of you guys would go out and purchase all that stuff for your hotel room? I don't see any hands going up, okay? Why? Because that's a waste of time and a waste of money, right? I'm just renting the room. That's not my permanent dwelling place. Now, at my house, if I had that same thing going on, I would think about buying some artwork. I would think about painting some walls. I would think about changing the linens and that sort of a thing. But this is just a hotel room. I'm just temporarily there. It's not a big deal. I'll be comfortable enough, but I will forego my comfort because of the time of my stay. Hebrews 11, chapter verse number 13, describes the same process as we take a look at it. Hebrews 11, chapter starting verse 13, reading through verse number 16. Look at this. Speaking of Abraham and Sarah, Enoch and Abel, Noah, look at what it says. These all died in faith, not having received the promises. Wait a second. I thought that God was faithful. I thought that God never failed. I thought that God always came through. How could this be? These all died in faith, not having received the promises? There's something wrong with that. And yet, notice how they died. They died in faith. In other words, they went down with the ship, so to speak. And they were not looking to a natural temporary promise. Yes, Abraham had a promise that all the land that he set his feet on, that he was to walk the width and the length and the breadth of the land. He was to go and walk all over it, and he did. God said to you and to your descendants, I have given this land. And Abraham believed the promise of God, and yet he died believing that promise, and he died in faith, not having received all the land. In fact, when he died, the only thing that he had was the burial ground he bought, a little field with a cave at the end of it. That's all he had in the land of Canaan. Because it did not matter the temporary things. What mattered to him was the eternal things. Look at what it goes on to say. It says, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Verse 14, for those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. Verse 15, and truly if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had the opportunity to return. Abraham and Sarah knew the way back to Ur. Come on, somebody, are you listening today? They knew the way that they came. And if they had thought, man, we had people, we had property, we had friends, we had all sorts of wealth, we had opportunities back there in Ur, the Chaldeans, we could live in a home and not in this tent. Man, if they had called that to mind, they could have gone back. And yet they believed the promise of God and they followed God in faith until the day that they died. Verse number 16, but now they desire a better, that is a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Now, we're going to go through these verses throughout this series that we're going to be doing on Sunday mornings. But today I want to focus just on verse number 13. Verse number 13, let's read it again. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For each and every one of us, as we're headed on this journey, just passing through, renting the room while we're here, just a little stay on the earth, we're going to have faith for the journey. There's going to have to be some things that we believe God for. And even if we don't receive the way we think that we should receive here on the earth, even if we see the promise of God and we understand it, that God is true and God is good no matter what, and we're going to have to believe God while we're here on the earth. So we need some faith for the journey. In verse number 13, I see three things that will encourage us and that will help us during our stay here on the earth. A couple of things. First one for today is this. They were assured. They were assured. That means that they were persuaded. They had crossed over from just a mere understanding or a mental acknowledgement now to a heartfelt faith. You could not get Abraham off of God. Once he had an encounter with God and started to follow God and believe God, and the more he did, the more he went, the more he obeyed, the more God revealed himself to him. God was now his covenant partner, and now there was no separation. God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Jacob. Now they are inseparable. See, they were firmly persuaded. They had crossed over. It wasn't just a mental assent with them. Now it was something that was a part of who they were. They were assured. See, they had seen with the eye of faith something far off. Do you know that you can find that in the Bible, that Abraham actually believed the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ? You might be thinking, well, wait a second, how could that work? Abraham came centuries before Jesus even stepped on the planet. How could that be that Abraham believed the gospel? Well, remember when Abraham was taking his son Isaac, and we'll discuss this as we get further into Hebrews chapter 11, as he was taking his son Isaac up the mountain, they had the wood, they had the fire, and Isaac says, Dad, where's the sacrifice? And what does Abraham say? He says, the Lord himself will provide a lamb for the sacrifice, speaking prophetically that God was going to do something. And you remember in his moment of obedience, he's about ready to slay his son, and the angel of the Lord stops him and says, now I know that you will obey my voice. And because you have not withheld your son, your only son, blessing, I will bless you. Multiplying, I will multiply you. And all the nations of the earth and your seed shall be blessed, speaking of the coming Messiah. And therefore, Abraham heard that word, and he believed that Messiah would come through his generations. He believed the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't see it with the natural eyes. Remember, he said the Lord will himself provide a lamb for the sacrifice. There wasn't a lamb in the thicket. It was a ram that was in the thicket. See, Abraham was looking forward with the eye of faith to the time when Jesus would come on the earth. Remember what Jesus said to the Pharisees? He says, Abraham saw my day, and he rejoiced. How did he do that? It was with faith. It's no different in our lives. We've got to get a hold of the promises of God. We've got to get a hold of the word of God. We have to see with the eye of faith afar off that God's promises are true. And we have to be persuaded. We have to cross over. Too many times I speak to people who call themselves Christians that I don't think are persuaded that this is real. Listen, it's okay to have questions. I understand that. It's okay to seek. I get that. There are questions and things that we grapple with and that we struggle. And guess what? Even as being a pastor for 20 years studying the Word of God, 2 decades of my life committed to just getting through the Word of God and learning and understanding, there are still things that I do not understand about God. But that doesn't stop me from being persuaded that it's true and that it's real. You know, science and modern-day criticisms will try and explain away the miracles of the Bible, try and explain away, well, we don't know who the real author is. You know, we don't know who actually did this. We don't know if that's real. How come this account is different than that account? And, you know, the Red Sea was probably just some wind blowing, and there was a sandbar, and the children of Israel. Listen, that's a bunch of hooey. You know what I'm saying? The Word of God is true. And we can take it at face value. When God says he parted the Red Sea and they walked through on dry land, that means that God parted the Red Sea and they walked through on dry land. Come on, somebody. You don't wipe out an army in 3 foot of water. It had to be crashing waves, walls of water that came down on them. My goodness. Jesus literally and physically raised people from the dead, healed the sick, cleansed the lepers. The apostles went out in miracles, signs, and wonders. Gifts of the Holy Ghost were being poured out. See, we've got to take that at face value. This is not just speaking in figurative language. This is real, this is relevant, and it's powerful for our lives today. But we've got to cross over. No longer saying, well, I don't know, maybe, maybe not. No, no, this is the Word of God. God said it, I believe it, and that settles it. Are you listening today? Now, I have to camp out on a little section just for a minute, because, you know, I think sometimes people get off and they think that because they believe something that it makes it true. That's not the case. Just because you believe something does not make it true. I could believe that my hair is going to turn purple polka dot in this morning's preaching and teaching, and that could never happen. You know what I'm saying? Just because I believed it doesn't make it true. But rather, because something is true, I can believe it. You see the difference? See, if we're going to see the Word of God and be assured of it, we have to get a hold of the truth first, and then we can believe it and bring it into the reality of our lives. In other words, there are facts, and there's the truth. Can I illustrate this for you? You guys here today? You guys are awfully quiet this morning, so I got to stir you up a little bit and fan the flames, because you guys are sitting there staring at me like a cow at a new gate, okay? But the truth of God's word says that by his stripes I was healed, right? We know that scripture. Now, if I was healed, then I am healed. And yet sometimes in life, the facts say different than the truth. Sometimes I get a little cough. Sometimes I have pain. Sometimes there's sickness that comes on my body. Well, does that mean that the word of God is any less true? No, it just means the facts aren't lining up with the truth. But because I'm persuaded, because I have a firm conviction and a belief I have crossed over, I do not just deny the facts. See, denying the facts doesn't make it any more spiritual. No, I might be sick, but the truth is, that's the facts. And I'll acknowledge, I'm not feeling well. I got a cough. I got this. I got that. But you know what? By his stripes, I was healed. See, when you are persuaded, you believe the word of God and you declare the word of God over your life, you hold on to that word. And eventually that word, even though you saw it afar off, even though it felt like too much pain, even though the doctors had already spoken now, but because you believe the word of God and you were persuaded, you latch on with the eye of faith and your hand of faith reaches out and grabs it and brings it into the natural life. And the facts will line up with the reality of the truth. See, that's how that works. We have to cross over and be persuaded. You're there in Hebrews. Turn a couple books back to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, let's take a look at this in the Word of God. 2 Timothy, the Apostle Paul is writing to his son in the faith. This is a very dear person to the Apostle Paul. The great apostle now is in jail. He knows that he's going to go and be with the Lord Jesus soon. And really, these are like Paul's last words to Timothy. How many of you know the last words are very important words? And when you leave those last words, you're leaving a legacy and know that there's weight that's added to those words because they are your last words. With that in mind, 2 Timothy chapter 1, starting in verse number 12, let's take a look at what it says. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse number 12 says this, For this reason, I also suffer these things, speaking about being in prison, speaking about the persecutions that have come in his life. For this reason, I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. See, he could have been ashamed. He could have said, wait, God, I thought I was supposed to go and start the Gentile churches. I thought that people were supposed to believe in Jesus. I started out so well. There were miracles. There were signs. There were wonders. Things were taking place, God. But everywhere I went, there was persecutions. And now here I am in shackles, in chains, waiting my death, God. Did I mess up? Did I not make it? And yet the word of God says, even though all that's happening, I'm not ashamed. Look at what it goes on to say. For I know. Everybody say, I know. Whom I have believed and am persuaded. Everybody say persuaded. See, he crossed over. There was no going back. He was an ultimate fan. He bought the shirt. He had the fan club. He put his email down. He was 100% invested in Jesus Christ, and there was no turning back. He had crossed over. I'm persuaded. What was he persuaded of? Look at this. I am persuaded that he, capital H, speaking of God, is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. You know what he just said? Doesn't matter what it looks like in the natural. Doesn't matter that I'm in a prison cell. Doesn't matter that I've got chains around my wrist. Doesn't matter that people are hating on me and spitefully using my name out there in the world. None of that matters. What matters is I'm persuaded that Jesus Christ, when I gave my heart and life to him, he's going to take care of me until that day. Capital D, speaking of the day of judgment, when God reckons to each one according to what they've done, their works while they're in the body. He says, I know, I'm persuaded. I know that I'm right where I need to be. I'm not ashamed of these chains. God has me right where he wants me. And therefore, I've crossed over. C.S. Lewis, once again, in The Weight of Glory, writes this. He says, if we consider the unblushing promises of reward promised in the Gospels, it would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We're half-hearted creatures, fooling around with drink and sex and ambition. When infinite joy is offered us like an ignorant child, who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offering of a holiday at sea. We are far too easily pleased. We have to cross over and not just settle for the natural. Otherwise, we're going to end up decorating the hotel room. Are you listening today? Faith for the journey. First one is this, is we have to be assured. Second one is this. Not only are we assured, but we see in Hebrews 11, chapter number 13, that they embraced. They saw those promises afar off. They were assured of them, and they embraced them. Now, that word embraced is a great word. It means literally to draw to oneself, to salute, call out to greet, to welcome, to wish well, or to receive joyfully. Can I illustrate this for you? My beautiful wife, Jessica, would you just come here? Isn't she lovely? Come here, girl. Oh, come here. This is what the word embrace means. Oh, this feels so good. Hi, honey.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Good. Do you want to go back to your seat?
Yes.
No, you can't go. See, that's what embrace means. It means to draw to yourself to, whoa.
You're
messing my message up. To not let go. And to bring close. No, okay, if you're going to do that, go back to your seat. I love you. But that's what embrace means. It means to draw close. Think about the word of God. Jesus has stretched out his arms, and he welcomes us. He calls to us. And we can see the promises of God afar off, and now we greet them. We welcome them. Lord, yes, yes to the promise. Yes to the blessing, God. Yes to my healing. Yes to my prosperity. Yes to my family being saved. Yes to my community being changed. Yes, Lord. Come, Lord Jesus. And you call out. You greet it joyfully. You welcome it, and you hold on to it. And don't let go. Amen. That's what we see in these Old Testament saints, that they not only were assured, not only crossed over in their faith, but now they embraced them. See, we have to release our grip on the temporary and the natural in order to receive the eternal and the spiritual. Can I get on a soapbox for a second? Is that okay? Some of you guys like this. Some of you guys don't like this. So there's going to be some amens and some oh me's. But just hold on. We'll get on the soapbox. We'll get off after a little bit. But, you know, I just went and saw this movie, War Room, with our staff. And it's just such a great movie. Anybody seen the movie? Isn't that wonderful? My goodness. If you haven't seen it, you need to go see it because it will change your life. And I just remember as I was watching it just thinking, my goodness, the quality, the videography and just the acting and the humor that they infused in there, the message, the cohesive message all the way across. These guys did a great job. And it pains me when people say, well, Christian movies aren't as good as worldly movies. Well, yeah, they don't have as much money. They don't have the big budgets and the special effects and all that kind of stuff. But guess what else they don't have? They don't have the filth, the nudity, the sex, the searing nastiness. They don't have the language. They don't have any of that stuff either. Last year, Lecrae had the number one album in the nation. That's a Christian rapper for those of you guys that don't know. Oh, but Christian music isn't as good as the world's music. Can I ask you, who invented music? My Bible says there are eternal songs of heaven going on day and night. They never stop praising God in song, singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And they've got such deep bass, the pillars of heaven shake. What kind of subwoofers do you need for that to happen? Oh, but Christian music's not as good as worldly music. No, we just have not yet released our grip on worldly things. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't watch a secular movie or TV show, or you can't listen to, you know, some guys, man, I like jazz, Pastor. You say, I can't listen to jazz. Go ahead and listen to your jazz, man. It's all right. And listen to the oldies. Listen to the hits. Listen to all that kind of stuff. Just be careful what you put in. You know, they're talking about bumping and grinding. You might want to bump that out of your CD player and grind it on the street. Can we talk? Is this okay? Christian art, oh, it's just cheesy. It's all Jesus pictures. Well, you know, we need to take a look at Jesus a little bit more often. But there are images in the Bible of heaven. And my goodness, we have this picture of Noah's Ark in our house that a guy drew. And my goodness, it's just gorgeous. I can sit there and stare, and I find something new every time I look at it. See, the Holy Spirit is the creative spirit of God, and he gives us the ability in music and art and science. Who are the ones who advanced science? You know, before the Christians came along and started looking at the earth and looking at the scriptures, they used to think the earth was flat. It was Christians who were at the forefront of making scientific discoveries. It was a Christian who was sitting under an apple tree that got knocked on his head that discovered gravity. Hello? They're teaching about these great men and women of God in secular institutions, and yet the church is getting down on Christianity. We need to release our grip on the world, and we need to embrace the things of God. All right, I'm off the soapbox. I'm off. All right, we'll get back onto the word. God is good. God is good. Jim Elliot, great missionary, South America, gave his life in martyrdom. Lived a short life, but had a lasting, eternal impact, said this. He said, Father, let me be weak. What a prayer that is. Let me be weak, that I might loose my clutch on everything temporal. Rather, open my hand to receive the nail of Calvary, as Christ was opened, that I, releasing all, might be released, unleashed from all that binds me now. Listen, this is not a time, this is not a day, this is not an hour to be decorating the hotel room. This is time for us to start planning for eternity, to look to our reward, to look to eternal things, to look to the heavens and lift up our eyes, because Jesus is coming for his church. And whether he comes first or we go and be with him, there's going to come a day where we will receive the eternal reward, but we have to see it afar off. We have to be assured of, we have to cross over, and we have to embrace them. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 says, "Beloved, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, people just passing through, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul." See, there's things that are going to come in and try and creep in. They're going to try and war against us, try and take us off of the things of God. Things that are going to try and get us distracted is fame and wealth and building up for the here and now, the people. You know, it's not a bad thing to store up for retirement. But guess what? Don't do that at the neglect of eternal things. Not a bad thing to plan for a rainy day, but don't do that at the neglect of eternal things. Not bad to be in relationships, but don't let relationships drag you down. No, let your relationships be a part of the kingdom of God. Be a witness, be a person who's telling someone about Jesus, helping others prepare for their eternity. We don't need to let wealth and money and sex and all that other stuff that God has designed and has a way and has a place for those things in our life. Don't let those things drag us away from the eternal things. We need to watch out. We need to be on the alert because we are at war, and we need to keep our eyes on eternal things. Turn me to the book of Philippians, because when we let go of the temporary, we need to grab hold of the eternal. Philippians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul is writing, and he's just been telling them how much stuff he had in the natural. I mean, this guy had it all. He had it going on. He had the right lineage. He was born in the right family, born on the right side of the tracks. Silver spoon in his mouth. He had the right education. He had the right teachers. He was doing the right thing, walking the right walk, talking the right talk. He had people backing him. He was persecuting the church and people liked it. And they said, "You keep going on, man. Keep doing what you're doing." He had letters from leadership so that he could continue to go after the church. He had all sorts of accolades from men. He had position. He had power. He had authority. And yet he says, I count all that stuff. When I met up with Jesus, I count all that stuff as trash, rubbish, dung. That's how worthless it is to me. And look at what he says in Philippians chapter 3, verse number 12, starting out. He says, "Not that I have already attained or I'm already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me." See, Jesus has his arms wide open for his bride. He's looking for the church to come and he's wanting to embrace us. And the apostle says, if Jesus is hugging me, I'm going to be hugging right back. Verse number 13, "Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." Church, we need to release our grip on the temporary things here and now and start reaching towards the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Can you say amen today? Amen. Faith for the journey. First one is this, assured. Second thing is this, embraced. And last one is this, confessed. Not only were they assured, and not only did they embrace those promises, even though they saw them afar off, they were assured of them. They crossed over. They embraced them. They held on to them. But now they confessed. You remember when Abraham was getting the burial plot, he said before the men of that time, "I'm just a stranger here and a pilgrim. Please give me a place where I can bury my dead out of my sight." In the same way, Jesus, when he was here before the kings of the earth, he made the good confession before Pontius Pilate. Pontius said, "So you are a king then?" And he says, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would have fought for me." Jesus made that confession, "I'm just passing through. This is not the eternal home. My kingdom is not of this world." And in the same way, as a people, we have to make that confession. We have to declare plainly that this is not my home, that heaven is my home. You say, "Wait a second, Pastor, are you telling me I got to tell somebody that?" I mean, it's one thing to be assured of them. It's another thing to embrace them, but wait, I got to go public with this? People are going to think I'm weird. I want to win them over to the Lord, and if they think that I'm weird, they're not going to listen to me. I've got to relate, Pastor. I don't know. I'm not that kind of person. You know, I think you should keep faith to yourself. I think it's a private matter, and it's a personal thing. And yet Jesus never said it was a private matter, did he? Come on, somebody, did he? No. You know what he said? He said, no one lights a lamp and hides it under the bed. No one takes their light and puts it under a basket. No, what do? They take that light and they place it up on a stand so that the whole house is filled with lights. What did he go on to say? You are the light of the world, therefore shine your light before men, that they may see your good works and glorify God on the day of visitation. See, we need to be a people that are outspoken about our faith. This is not a private matter. This is a public thing. And we need to let people know. And guess what? If they think that you're weird and they don't receive your message, you don't have to be with them in eternity anyways. Say, Pastor, that's not nice. That's why we witness to them, because we want them to cross over. See, because it only takes one. It only takes one crazy person who's crazy enough to believe God, who has crossed over and who has embraced the promise, to start to declare plainly, I'm in love with the Lord. I have crossed over. I'm sold out to Jesus. Layoffs on the job start coming. Turmoil in the world. Somebody comes up to you, aren't you worried? No, I'm not worried. I got Jesus. I'm going to go sit over here. Layoffs start coming. Hey, do you think you're going to get canned? I don't know. I don't care. Listen, Lord's going to take care of me anyways. What about you? I'm going to sit over here. They're at the water cooler. Everybody's gossiping. You come walking up. Oh, here comes holier than thou. You walk up. Hey, what'd you do this weekend? I was in church. Wait, you went to church? You gave it, what, your weekend? You could have been out. It was so beautiful. It was so warm. You should have been at the beach. No, I was in church. Church is much better than the beach. I can go to the beach any day, but listen, the presence of God, that's where I want to be. That's where I'm going to be forever. Well, I heard about your church. All they're after is your money. Yeah, and I gladly gave it. Wait a second. You would give your money? No, yeah, because they're not all about money. They're all about people. They're all about Jesus. They're all about winning souls. They're all about reaching the lost. They're all about helping people. I'm not going to do that without money, so hey, I want to be a part of that. When I go to heaven, I'm not going to need money. The streets are lined with gold. Come on, somebody. See, there's a difference. And then when their life has fallen apart, they're going to look at everybody else who's worried, who has no answers. And then they're going to look at you smiling and humming the song that you were singing earlier, that you were doing the little electric slide to beforehand. And they're going to be like, this person's crazy, but they got something I don't got. Maybe I should go find out what it is they have to say, because you made the good confession before the people. When I was young, my brother and I would go over to our grandma's house, different holidays, things like that. And she always had birds. We loved looking at the birds. And she had cockatiels and parakeets and parrots and all that kind of stuff. And I remember one year we were sitting there, and my brother and I were playing at the coffee table, you know, a little coffee table, just sitting there playing. And we heard the phone ring. We looked around and, you know, kept on playing. It's not our house. Someone's calling grandma. And we heard the answering machine beep, and no one left a message. We continued playing. After a while, the phone rang again. Answering machine beeped. No message. Third time, phone rang. We stopped and we looked at each other and we looked up at the phone. Is anybody going to answer that? Then we heard the answering machine beep. Now, the answering machine was up on the wall. Okay, it was one of those old ones that the light flashed when the message went off, you know. And we're looking and there's no light flashing. And all of a sudden we hear somebody leaving a message. But we can't understand what they're saying, because it was kind of muffled and kind of low and just sounded like a whole bunch of little whistles and chirps. And we realized that's not the answering machine. That's the stupid bird over there making that noise. Now, you know, two boys, we all of a sudden got excited, and so we're waiting, you know, waiting to hear it. And after a little while, sure enough, the phone rings, but it's not the phone, it's the bird. The bird is ringing, and then after a while, the bird is beeping. The answering machine bird is picking up the phone call, and then the bird is leaving a message for my grandma. I don't know what he was saying, you know, like, come, can you come and clean up my newspaper and give me some more food and water or something? I don't know. But my goodness, we had such a good time listening to that bird. Now, have you ever looked at a person who calls themselves a Christian's life? And they're talking the right thing. They're saying all the right stuff. They've got it all down. And yet you look on the back end of their life and you say, wait a second, they're a mess back here. What's going on? Could it be that they're just parroting a promise? That their confession is just lip service and not really heart agreement? See, because that word agreement that they confessed, that word means to agree with and to say the same thing. Now think about it like this. Let's say you were reading an article in a newspaper. And as you're reading that article, you were kind of opposed to what the author was saying, but then you saw their reasoning, you saw their logic, you saw how they laid out. They took you on a path of understanding, and you realized, wow, you know what? They really have something here. I thought differently, but you know what? What they're saying is true. I really do see that, and I do think that. As you're doing that, confirmation's coming to you. You're seeing other things. There's other things taking place, and now all of a sudden you're looking at it, and you're saying, no, that's real. That's what it's really all about. And then in a conversation, maybe at the breakfast table with your spouse or with a friend or something like that, you're talking about it, and up out of you comes this same understanding that you had just read about in the paper. And they say, oh, I read that article too. You know, that's just their thoughts. No, I see that, and I've experienced that, and now I know it to be true. See, it's no longer something from someone else, even though those words represented them and their ideas and their thoughts. Now it is a part of you, and now when you talk from a place, this is who I am, this is what I believe. See, it's no different with the Word of God. This is the ideas and the thoughts, not of man. This is not the wisdom of man, the ideas or philosophies. This is the Word of God. This is God himself, God in the flesh. This is the Word of God to you and to me. And as you read this and as you see this, it becomes a part of you. See, when you're assured of it, when you've crossed over now, not just mentally, but now you receive it and you embrace it. It's not just something outside of you. God in us, us in him, it becomes one. It's part of you. And now when you talk, that confession is made that I am a Christian. I believe the Word of God. I can have the promises of God. And I know God is faithful and true. It comes up out of you because it's a part of you. That's the confession that we see in Hebrews, the 11th chapter that the Old Testament saints gave. They not only were assured of them and embraced them, but they confessed them. It came up out of who they are. It was a part of them. And in our lives, if we're going to make it with the things of God, we can't just parrot a promise and try and be that answering machine like the bird. But no, now it's who we are. It's what we do. We are believers. We're sold out for Jesus. Turn back with me to Hebrews, the 10th chapter this time. We'll end with this, Hebrews chapter 10. Take a look at it with me in Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Look at verse number 23. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 23 says these words. It starts out with two little words, let us. You know what that means? It means it's a choice. We can choose to do this or we can choose not to do this. But he says, let us. Let us choose this. Let us do what? Let us hold fast the confession. That speaking the same thing in agreement with the Word of God. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. We may die in faith. We may go down with the ship. But listen, it's better going than going down with the ship of the world. Because the ship of the world is going down and it's never coming back up. But the ship of the Lord, Jesus, raises the dead. Therefore, I'm going to go on with God. And I'm going to hold fast my confession. Even if I have to die in faith. Because I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've entrusted to him until that day. Isn't God good? What did we learn today? Faith for the journey. Number one, we learned that we need to be assured of the things of God. We need to cross over. Number two, embrace them. Get a hold of them and hold them tight. And number three, that we can make the good confession out of who we are because the Word of God is on the inside of us. Did you guys get something from the Word of God today? Hallelujah. Thank you guys for staying put. I want to talk to you guys about your eternal life because some of you guys are decorating the hotel room and don't even know it. You haven't yet latched on to the eternal dwelling place. You don't really understand those things yet. And even though you like them, even though you understand what we were talking about today, I want to make sure that this is not just something because it'd be a tragedy if we talked about all that and then we let you go and your heart wasn't right with God and you died and you ended up going to hell and not going to heaven. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, hold on a second, because I don't really believe in hell. That's just a fairy tale parents made up to scare their children into being good. And yet, what I see in the Bible talks about hell, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of hell. It's a very real place. And just by burying your head in the sand doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. It's a real place. Now listen, God does not want you to go there. He's not some sadistic maniac in the heavens sending people to hell and take pleasure in that. No, he grieves over that. He mourns, he weeps when people go to hell. That's why he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross, so that we didn't have to go to hell. But God loves us so much that he allows us the free will choice to choose where we go while we're here on the earth, whether heaven or whether hell. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, all roads lead to heaven. I don't have to worry about that. All roads lead to heaven. But could you show that to me in the Bible where it says all roads lead to heaven? I haven't found that scripture yet. I wish it were true, but it's not. Can't just do whatever you want to do, or I do whatever I want to do, or the churches out there do whatever they want to do, and we're going to make it. Let's apply that logic to the earth for a second. What if I told you, just drive around as long as you want, wherever you want, you're going to make it to the moon because all roads lead to the moon. You'd say, you're crazy. You can drive around the earth as long as you want and you will never make it. In the same way, what makes us think we could do whatever we want to do and we'll make it to heaven? There's one way to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. It's God's heaven. We've got to get there God's way. Now, listen, God's way is not by just being good. A lot of people think, if I just be good enough, I'll get to go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible say you can be good enough to get to heaven? There's no grading scale in the back of the Bible, no line, no curve that you have to be above. Not like your good outweighs your bad and you tip the scales over and then I made it because I was more good than bad. Listen, Bible says if you're trying to get to heaven with your goodness, the standard is perfection. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. None of us is perfect except one, his name is Jesus. Your goodness compared to God's goodness, like filthy rags, is going to get thrown out and not going to get to stay. Sometimes people think, well, you know, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. Hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. Took you to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. You've always thought of yourself as a Christian born in America. America's a Christian nation, isn't it? Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhists, Muslims, Hindus. We're Christians. We're going to heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're raised in church, parents tell you you're Christian, take you to religious classes, wear religious jewelry, be baptized or christened as a child, because you're born in America that you get to go to heaven? It doesn't work like that. And nowhere, check it out, nowhere do I see in the Bible, it says, because you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Come on, let's talk about your eternal life. Listen up, because God wants to speak to you right now. Somebody said, well, Pastor, I get all that, but you know, not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church right now, sitting in front of you. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, let me ask you something. What if we applied that logic here on earth? What if I told you that, you know, I decided I wanted to be a part of the Angels baseball organization. I went and bought an Angels uniform, went and got my bat, my ball, my glove, drove down to Anaheim, sat in the dugout in Angel Stadium, thought that I was going to get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen? Security's going to find me sitting there, drag me out and lock me up. Why? Because I'm not a member of the Angels organization. In the same way, you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, and that makes you Christian. You know what that's like? That's like that parrot making the sounds, going through the motions, and yet he will never become an answering machine. Can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you Christian. So you say, well, Pastor, I get that, but you don't get it. My last church, I got involved. I carried the pastor's Bible. I made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I mean, I did all that stuff. Got a membership class. Got a membership card to that church. Went to the class and got the card. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, could you just show that to me in the Bible? Because now we're back to good works, aren't we? No one in the Bible says God's looking for your volunteer hours, looking for you to sing in a choir or carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. It doesn't work like that. God's not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. And yet a lot of people think that they're going to go to heaven just because they helped out in church. Say, okay, Pastor, but I got you on this one. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate Easter and the resurrection every year of my life. Sing the songs of Christmas. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. But if you read your Bible, you'd know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christian. The devil himself can quote scriptures and knows who Jesus is, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody, look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. Jesus said, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They rake through the coals in movies, Hollywood, television, books, and the internet. But let's not look to society to find out about what biblical terms mean. Let's find out from the Bible. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. Remember, we talked about being persuaded. It's where you cross over and you give all, holding nothing back, 100%. It's all or nothing with God. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Those are gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying, lukewarm? What's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again. Occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's what your relationship is like with God, then you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Listen, Jesus is saying in or out. Either you are or you aren't. But don't expect to ride the fence, play games, and think that you're going to get to make it. Today, have you given God all of your heart? Have you given God all of your life? If not, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do just that. In a moment, I'm going to count to three, just like this. One, two, three, and bang, pop my hands together. When you hear the sound of my hands pop together, just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's push past that today, because Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, it's your call. It's your choice. I'm a man. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, better than ending up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. So it's your call. It's your choice. You sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right with God. You can allow the devil to whisper in your ear, this is just emotionalism, this is just fanaticism, you don't need to do this, you're already okay. Or you can listen to someone who loves you. Listen to the God who sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross so you didn't have to die and go to hell. You can respond, giving him all of your heart, all of your life. You can be persuaded, crossing over, embracing that promise, confessing today with your actions that you want to give God all of your heart, and that you want to give God all of your life. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've never done this, never given God all of your heart and your life? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today's your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? You know who you are. Come on. It's time to stop running. Time to come back to Jesus. Who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the hamburger down, get ready to get your hand up, then tell an usher to come into the church service right afterwards. Who should raise your hand online, wherever you're at, across the nation and around the world, you can raise your hand right where you're at. God sees, God's watching. He knows right where you're at, and he's speaking to you. Get ready to get your hand up, and then right afterwards, you can minimize your video browser, click the button that says Respond to God, or go to our homepage where it says How to Know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. Thank you. There's one, there's two, there's three. Got you up on top. God bless you. Who else today? Three wise people already. Anybody else real quick? There's four. Got you over there. Thank you. There's five up there. Got you. Anybody else real quick? Five wise people already. On this side, there's six. Got you over there. Thank you. Seven in the family room. God bless you guys. Who else today? Listen, I didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. You say, Pastor, you're pushing me. Yeah, because the devil's trying to push you out of this. Thank you, number eight. Gotcha. Don't listen to him. He wants to kill you, wants to destroy your life, wants to steal your future. Jesus came to give you real life, abundant life. Anybody else? We've got about eight wise people already. Where are you at, number nine, number 10? Come on, if that's you, just raise your hand up. I can't raise it for them. They got to do it themselves. If they want to do it themselves, come on, you can do that today. But if not, it's your call. It's your choice. Thank you. God bless you right there. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? Number nine. God bless you. Number 10, come on, you're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah. Go ahead. You can do it. You can do it in a safe and friendly place. Where are you at? Come on, just raise it up high when I'm looking your direction. Number 10, go for it. That's you. Anybody else real quick? Come on. Come on, where are you at? Number 10, just raise it up high for me. Right now, if that's you. Anybody else? Where are you at? Just give me a little wave if you're raising your hand right there. Thank you. God bless you. Got you there, number 10. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 10 wise people. Hallelujah. God's good. All right, you don't get saved just by raising your hand. That's your acknowledging. Now, we want to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. We want to encourage you with some things and help you on your new walk with God. Can't do that till we get you down here. So I want to just do this. No one leaves during this time. Let's all stand. And if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, get your stuff, get a friend if you need a friend, get in the aisle, and meet me up front because we're going to change destinies today. So you come. Let's welcome them as they come. Come on down. Come on down. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down.
Far as I can see, and I know from experience, you are good to me.
Come on, they're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. From the family rooms, you can bring your children. They'll remember this. Come on down.
From words cannot describe, oh God, everything you are to me.
They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Anybody else, if you need to come, just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Come on, they're still coming. You can come too. There's room for you. Anybody else? Come on. Come on. We'll wait for you. Come on. Hey, all right, everybody. A whole lot more than 10 people up here. Beautiful families up here. God bless you guys. This is the best decision of your entire life. You can put a smile on your face. It's a good thing. It's not a bad thing, okay? I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Nothing weird is going to go on, okay? I want to let you know that in advance. Sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? I'm about as weird as you're going to get around here, okay? He's cool. He's going to do three things. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. And then finally, he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, let me describe it to you like this. It's a friend in church who will help you get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back decorating the hotel room. You know what I'm saying? That you can start building for eternity. And they'll teach you how to do that, help you get strong so you go on with God all the days of your life, okay? It's quick, easy, free, all right? He'll describe that to you, and then he'll let you come right back out, and your friends and family will wait for you. So if you guys will make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.